Hello students, I have come up with a new video which is important from examination point of view also. Why is this lesson so important in class 11? One reason is because it is about Chinese history and you know the position of China in these days, and there are so many similarities between Chinese history and Nepalese history of that time. Also, this chapter has so many important philosophies connected with political and cultural scenarios which can bring a great change in the country. You will know after going through this lesson detailly. So students, remember that this lesson is very important from examination point of view as well, even for your finals, I would say. So let's begin our question answer video of Unit 4 from History and Culture field, and the topic of the lesson is Qing Dynasty. Turn to page 36, students. Let's begin ways with words. Question A, match the words with their meanings. Brevity means number 5, lasting only for a short time. B, conquest, which matches with number 7, victory over a place or people by use of military force. C, resemblance, matches with 1, that is the state of being alike. D, barbarian, matches with number 2, a member of an uncivilized group of people or culture. E, ally, matches with number 10, one state united to another by a treaty or a league for a military purpose. F, nobility, matches with number 3, state of being noble in character, quality or rank. G, ruthlessness, matches with number 9, character of having no pity or compassion. H, decimation, matches with number 8, the killing or destruction of a large number of a population. I, harsh, matches with number 6, cruel. J, elixir, matches with number 4, liquid that is believed to cure all illnesses. Now question B, find the following words in the text and use them in sentences of your own. Students, if you don't know the meaning of these, please find out yourself. I have made sentences of them. A, invasion. The invasion of their land was made impossible by strongly reinforcing their all 4 gates by iron doors. B, disregard. Let's not disregard their special request to us. C, paramount. Unity of people is a paramount necessity at this critical stage of war. D, populace. They did not have the optimum populace to retaliate in the war. Populace means population. Revolt. They were ready to revolt, but the bad weather did not support them. F, assassination. They had planned for the assassination of the corrupt ministers. G, serfdom. Serfdom was eradicated from their country about 200 years ago. Let's go to page 38. B, answer these questions. Question A, why is the Zhao age called a feudal age? Answer, the Zhao government had a strong resemblance to some of the forms of feudalism in medieval Europe, which is why the Zhao age is sometimes referred to as a feudal age. Question B, what is the location advantage of the Qing? Of the many Chinese states, the Qing had the advantage of a favorable location. Its territory in modern Shaanxi province is well guarded from the east by mountains and gorges and has easy access to the North China Plain through the Yellow Passes. Question C, what contributed to the success in the warfare as described in the text? Answer, the states of Qing and Chu were the strongest which was due in part to the locations of these two states being able to command vast resources. They were also able to expand their borders without fear of immediate conflicts, unlike the other states, and so could obtain still further resources. The benefit and the huge size of the Qing army and their expert use of the chariot contributed to their success in warfare. Another factor is also their ruthlessness in battle. Question D. Why did the Qing invite the foreign advisor Xiang Yang? Qing was lacking early on in skilled intellectuals and politicians and therefore had to look beyond its borders for talented people. Xiang Yang was one of those foreign talented persons and he would have a lasting influence on the Qing Empire. Question E. What were the key features of the Qing political system? Fear and control were the key features of Qing's political system. In addition to this, one's personal importance to the empire was also a key element. F. How were the people treated during the Qing period? Answer. If a person did not behave according to the rules, they were quartered or beheaded. If a person meant nothing to the state, they actually meant nothing objectively. Their life was meaningless. Those who contributed the most to the state were highly rewarded, while those who did nothing were considered as useless and were sent to work as slaves on Xi Yangdi's building projects such as the Great Wall of China, the Grand Canal, and the roads were increased for the ease of travel and trade. They expected every people to contribute for their nation. They were not allowed to stay idle. Question G. Why did Xi Yangdi stop educating ordinary people? Answer. Xi Yangdi stopped educating ordinary people because he believed that uneducated people were easier to control and so the people should remain stupid. Question H. What did the Qing achieve by the legalism in practice? Legalism had a lasting effect on the entirety of Chinese history. The Qing dynasty created the standard of bureaucratic government and the legalistic policies first initiated by the Qing are still seen in China today. Question I. Why did Xi Yangdi never sleep in the same room for two consecutive nights? Xi Yangdi never slept in the same room for two consecutive nights as he had a constant fear of assassination. J. What are the everlasting marks of the Qing dynasty? The everlasting marks of the Qing dynasty is the Great Wall of China and the Terracotta Army in Xian. Now comes the critical thinking part. Question A. The Great Wall and the Taj Mahal are the creation of the autocratic rulers. Present your view for or against this statement. Yes. Both the Great Wall and the Taj Mahal are the creation of the autocratic rulers. The Great Wall of China was built in order to protect the Northern Empire of China from enemy attacks, also known as the barbarian invasion. There are altogether 19 walls in the Great Wall of China. The first wall was constructed in the 7th century BC. Then, its continuous expansion and renovation took place during the period of three dynasties, that is Han Dynasty, Ming Dynasty, and Qing Dynasty. The rulers only initiated the idea. There is a great collective effort of millions of Chinese people in building the wall. These people were forced by the autocratic government to work hard in these projects as a form of punishment. It is mentioned in the book that during the rule of Shi Hengdi, they practiced legalism throughout the nation, in which it was believed that every people of the nation should be of some use or should contribute for the development of one's nation. If the people did not behave accordingly, then they were severely punished, like they were beheaded or assassinated by the government. Those who made great contribution to the nation were highly respected and rewarded. And those who were useless and stayed idle were taken as slaves, and they were sent as laborers to work in projects of building the Great Wall of China, the Great Canal, and the Silk Road construction projects. So many people died due to hardship during these projects, but as there was an autocratic rule in the state, this was not cared for and was not taken seriously. The autocratic rulers were more concerned about keeping their name, fame, and reputation rather than in the well-being of their people. Similarly, we read in history that Taj Mahal was the creation and dream project of an autocratic ruler, the Mughal Emperor Shah Jahan, who built this replica in the loving memory of his wife Mumtaz Mahal, who died in childbirth in 1631. Actually, the Taj Mahal was designed and constructed by a highly talented team of architects, engineers, and highly specialized craftsmen from India and Europe, and it took more than 20 years for its completion. It is said that Shah Jahan cut off the hands of the artist to prevent them from recreating the same kind of replica elsewhere. More than 20,000 workers had labored hard to ready this masterpiece. So, the credit for the construction of Taj Mahal should not be given only to the rulers. Question B. How do you describe the pros and cons of feudalism? Feudalism is a dominant social system that first existed in Europe in the Middle Ages, in which the nobility got lands as reward from the crown, that is the king, in exchange for their military services. The pros or good side of feudalism is that it helped protect communities from the violence and warfare and helped to make the central government strong. They protected them and kept them out of powerful invaders. They in turn became powerful in their area. They were called lords. So, whenever the peasants or farmers were in need of financial assistance or loans, they helped them. Farmers were called peasants at that time. Spelling of peasants is P-E-A-S-A-N-T-S, peasants. So, the lords were the people who kept away people's worries. But the cons or bad side of feudalism is that lords were the rich people and the peasants or serfs were very poor. So this dominant system divided the society into two classes, the poor and the rich. The farmers who were poor and weak had to depend on the lords. They imposed their power very badly on these farmers. The peasants or farmers had to serve the lords, work in their lands for free. They could not leave their lords' lands. They were like slaves, and their entire life was completely dependent on them. They had no freedom. There are two questions in creative writing section. A. Write an email to your friend living abroad stating the contribution of Prithvi Narayan Shah in the unification of Nepal. Students, when you send email to your friends, you have to log in first, and there you will see compose. So click compose. Then there will be two where you have to type your friend's email address. Let's suppose you are sending this email to your friend Pinky. So her email address is pinky505@gmail.com. Always remember, you have to type email address without any spaces in between. Then there will be from. Your email address will already be there, so no need to type. Let's say you are Rinku and your email address is rinku662@gmail.com. And there will be subject. Here you have to type your subject in brief, the subject in which you are sending an email. This can be seen as an initial when your friend will open her emails. So looking at the subjects, she will open the most important emails first. Then in the box, you have to type the message. Sometimes if you have prepared the document in Word, then you can attach the document. But let's say you went into the box and typed this letter. The email to your friend Pinky appears like this. Dear Pinky, as you had asked me to state the contribution of Prithvi Narayan Shah in the unification of Nepal, I have sent you some points which will definitely help you to write the answer in your exam. Point number one. If Prithvi Narayan Shah had not thought of unifying tiny states such as Baisi Chobisi Rajya, Nuakot, Chaudandi, Gorkha, Makwanpur, Kumau Garhwal, Simla, Sikkim, and Kantipur, Bhadgaon, Patan, and Kirtipur states inside Kathmandu Valley, and many other small states which were within the area of the present nation Nepal, then we wouldn't be calling ourselves Nepalese right now. We don't know to which country we would belong to. We have our present identity due to Prithvi Narayan Shah, so we respect him for that. Point number two, after unification also, he consistently worked hard until he died to further expand the territory of Nepal and to strengthen its unity. Point number three, we appreciate the fact that he was a very far-sighted, brave ruler who never gave up on his dreams. One example of this is that he established the capital of Nepal at Kathmandu and not in Gorkha. Point number four, he not only united the small states but also united the people and strengthened the national unity by establishing a strong base of caste, religion and culture. He unified people of different caste, religion and culture and gave them the feeling of one nationality, that is Nepalese. Point number five, he even defeated the Bengali troop of Mir Kazim and the British troops who were representing the Indian subcontinent at Sindhuli. His wars clearly demonstrate that his battles within the Himalayan region aimed to win the hearts and minds of the Nepalese people. Then you have to end your email by saying that, I think this email letter will be of some use to you. See you soon from your friend Rinku. Then you can send this email to your friend. Now question B of creative writing. The table shows the major political movements in Nepal after the end of the Rana regime. Write a paragraph of each event with their key contributions in the political landscape of Nepal. Students, if you get questions like this, you have to write just a paragraph, that is a paragraph containing about 5 to 8 sentences, not more than that. So number one, establishment of democracy in the year 1951. On 18 February 1951, King Tribhuvan announced Nepal's first steps to democracy with a historical proclamation and a cabinet headed by Sir Mohan Shamsher Jang Bahadur Rana and split among the Ranas and the Nepali Congress Party. This was a political movement against the tyrannical Rana regime that eventually resulted in the end of the 104-year-long Rana rule in the country. Number two, first general election in the year 1959. General elections were held in Nepal from 18 February to 3 April 1959 to elect the 109 members of the first House of Representatives, the lower house of the Parliament of Nepal. They were held under the provisions of the 1959 Constitution, which had been adopted on 12 February. Number three, dismissal of elected government in the year 1960. The Nepali Congress Party was victorious and their leader Biseshwar Prasad Koirala formed a government and served as Prime Minister. But by 1960, King Mahendra had changed his mind and dissolved Parliament, dismissing the first democratic government. Number 4. National Referendum in the year 1980. A referendum on the system of government was held in Nepal on 2 May 1980. Voters were offered the choice between a non-partisan panchayat system and a multi-party system. The panchayat system received a slim majority of 54.99%, whereas multi-party system only received 45.2% of the total votes. Voter turnout was 66.9%. Number 5. People's Movement won in the year 1990. The movement was marked by the unity between the various political parties. Not only did various communist parties group together in the United Left Forum, that is ULF, but they also cooperated with parties such as Nepali Congress, NC. One result of this unity was the formation of the Communist Party of Nepal, Unified Marxist-Leninist, or UML. Number 6. People's Movement 2 in the year 2006. In April 2006, another People's Movement was launched jointly by the Democratic Parties, focusing most energy in Kathmandu, which led to a 19-day curfew. Eventually, King Gyanendra relinquished this power and reinstated the parliament. Now, the last question of this lesson, it is on page 41. This is the project work for the students. Find the similarities and differences between the Qing dynasty in China and the Rana regime in Nepal. You can search information on the internet and prepare a comparative chart. Once you complete your project, compare it with the charts from your friends. The Qing dynasty in China and the Rana regime of Nepal unified the people's culture by togetherness. Both the nations focused on with the integration of people into a culture. The only difference that we find in them is that Rana regime follow conflict teachings to the people, whereas the Qing dynasty follow the philosophy of legalism to the people. Qing dynasty follows the legalist proposals for state order. It proposed the specified punishments for each crime. There was a harsh authoritarian rule in the country, whereas during the period of Rana regime, the country was ruled by Ranas only. So Rana rule was called family rule. Rana rule was also autocratic in nature, but the people's rights and needs were not disturbed. I hope, students, you got answers to all your questions of this important lesson, Qing Dynasty. Thank you for being with me till the end. Hope to see you in our next lesson. Bye-bye and take care.